your guest was speaking about how meditation and prayer, it takes, what did you say, it was 1% of a certain
square root,
of a population?
Square root of 1% of a given population is what the statistics show in the studies that were published. This was in the Journal of Conflict Resolution, December 1988. What it takes to jumpstart the effect, but more people certainly make it happen quicker.
Okay, well, I'm a firm believer in what I feel is going to be, so to speak, like a global conscious awakening coming soon. And you were talking about it earlier, sort of along the same lines as that, too. What I'm suggesting is, you were saying that there's 8 billion people. We would only need 8,000 people, you were saying.
Of a little over 6 billion people on the planet, if you, you know, on your calculator, the square root of, you take 1% of 6 billion, then you take the square root of that 1%, and the numbers are just a little over 8,000 people. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, and even, you know, with a large amount of people, anything, I mean, that's going to be, you know, positive anyways. So, but I mean, if there's any, George, if you're planning on having any focused consciousness, or if you guys...
Always.
I wanted to see what you guys thought of that to sort of jumpstart peace. I mean, it would make peace, you know, in the Middle East, for example. I know that experiment that you did the other night, George, with your other guest.
Mm-hmm. With Raymond Grace. And I've got to tell you, I'm not going to count the day 100 people died, because that had already occurred or was occurring while we were on the air, because it was early morning. It was morning in Baghdad by that time. But
oh yeah,
today I would believe to be one of the official days of the start date. Mm. And they had minimal casualties today. So I'm going to watch it for a couple weeks.
Well, you know, one of the things the studies found, both George and David, is that when something like this happens, it doesn't work so well to say, you know, peace in Jerusalem or peace in Baghdad. It's about peace, period. When consciousness is feeling peace, it appears that all that can happen is peace. And when we polarize it and say, you know, here's the good guys, here's the bad guys, and peace over here, and let these guys win, it doesn't appear to be effective in that way. This is about it's about a universal sense of peace, and in the presence of that peace, all that happens is peace. Global studies have been done. The problem is that this is still being looked at as something you do for a moment or 10 minutes or an hour, and then you stop and you walk away. And what the masters of our past have told us, and what the laboratory experiments are showing, is it's not something you do, it's something you be. It's a way of being. If the world is mirroring what we are feeling collectively, then we're invited to collectively to feel that peace, as Gandhi said,
yes,
to feel that peace in your heart to the best of your ability. And we all have times where we can feel it more than others, certainly, but to the best of our ability. And in that way, life becomes literally the perpetual prayer. That's the part that has not been really really picked up on a large scale. So that's why these things aren't as successful maybe as they could be.
I agree with you, and that's how I've been learning to live, and I have been living like that. So I will continue to project my positive energy onto the globe and try to help evolve humanity in every way that I can, and I will enjoy the rest of the program. Thank you, and you guys both have a wonderful evening.
Thanks, David. Thanks for calling in tonight. Take care.
Appreciate you being part of the program. What do people get when they go to your website, Greg?
What they'll find is a schedule of we do multimedia events all over the world, George. We've got a lot of them in this country. We're showing the video clips of these healings that I'm talking about. We're showing moving images demonstrating the experiments and direct experience in the room. And it's a lot of fun. They're fast moving programs. Of course, all of our recordings are there, and all the references that we're talking about here tonight, the technical references that were too much to mention all in the air, they're all listed under the references section on that website, gregbraden.com.
All right, well, stick with us, Greg Braden, our guest. We'll be back. We're going to take final phone calls. I can't believe how fast this program has run. And, Greg, we want to talk about time also. Time travel, maybe, throughout the Matrix. We'll find out. Well, on our next Coast to Coast program, it'll be our Friday night into Saturday morning open lines. Just about anything could happen. But we'll be right back. We'll take final phone calls with Greg Braden on Coast to Coast AM. Rapid night tonight, Greg. How does this equate to time travel, if at all? if you can hit the matrix.
Once again, George, and again, this, we talk about more detail in the book, but it's because if time travel is happening, there must be a conduit, something that we're moving through. And within the realm of human experience we're talking about, time and space really don't exist in this realm. That's why, you know, the military has used the divine matrix. They didn't call it that. But even as far back as the early 90s in the first Gulf War, they would train individuals in what we now call remote viewing, sitting in an office in Virginia to find Scud missile locations in Iraq, so we didn't have to send live troops in and risk their lives to find them, and they would pinpoint them that way. So distance in that respect really doesn't mean the same thing as it means in our 3D conscious beta state. Time in the laboratory, there experiments have been done, fascinating experiments, where quantum particles have been taken into the present moment. In other words, 5 seconds ago, they moved this particle from where it was then to where it is now, and they know all the properties about the particle now. They change that particle now, and what they've found is that it actually changes what it is that happened before the particle ever got there. It's a mind-boggler when you think about these things. But the reason that I talk so much about what's happening with the quantum particles is because we're made of those particles. For 75 years, scientists have tried to convince us we're made of quantum particles, and we believe that now. And now that they're finding all these miraculously, seemingly miraculous things that these particles do, they say, well, that has nothing to do with our everyday world. And the question I'm asking in the book is, are those quantum particles, are they showing us the anomalies of science, or are they showing us the possibilities that await us as we learn this language of the divine matrix? And every one of those miracles, whether it's being in two places at once or instantly connected as in remote viewing, or going from physical energy into invisible matter like the healing of the tumor, every one of those things that we've mentioned, people have done in the past. And if one person can do it, it's probably there for all of us. It's about learning to master this language, and the language is based not in our brains, but it's in our hearts.
All right, let's go to the phones again. Wildcard Line, you're on Coast to Coast with us. Hi there.
Hi, this is Tana, and I'm in Montana.
Hi,
how
Tana.
Are you guys?
Hey, great to hear from you tonight in Montana.
Oh, it's wonderful here. I have kind of a question for you, but a little bit of background. Ever since I was a young child, probably since I could tell time, 11-11 has always been just incredibly important to me. In my young head, that was the time that I had a phone call to God, and I got a minute. And I would be able to catch it. It was odd. I could catch it at least once a day, usually twice a day. And my belief was that I was able to talk to God, ask him for something, and then the angels were going to spread their little wings, and occasionally feathers would fall out of their wings, and they would come down to earth, and my prayer would be answered. Well, growing up in this abusive household and a family that did not believe in God, I realized that God wasn't going to just magically give me a new family. So I kind of changed my thought process. I don't know quite how I did it, but I decided to just be in that moment, in that minute that I had with God, and hope that possibly that feather would fall. And I stopped hoping for myself, but I started hoping for others to possibly be kinder to me, or for something grand to come into my life, something wonderful, or somehow find peace within myself. I'm almost 42 now, and for the last 30 years or so, I've been able to do that. And as I've talked to friends and family, even though I know they think I'm a little out in left field, they know that 11-11, if I don't catch it, they catch it. And they do respect that time, and it's quiet because they know that I'm talking, or I'm just trying to find some kind of inner peace. My question to you is, I've raised my two daughters to believe in this, and they stop at 11-11, and they also speak their, you know, find their presence with God, or their spiritual being, or whatever you want to call them. I was wondering if I could get the people who actually do stop at that time and do believe that there is the power within us.